It's Reformation Sunday, but when you walk outside, it looks a little like Christmas. Don't tell me God doesn't have a sense of humor. Your live stream today is given by all of you, the members of Salem. Please note that Tuesday night for Trunk or Treat, the event is being held in the alleyway, the east side of Salem, and not the west side, as was previously communicated. In the event the weather isn't bad, you know, like it's snowing or something maybe, Trunk or Treat will be held in the fellowship hall, and participants will host tables down there with goodies for the kids. Today is the last Sunday of the Noising offering for the Maui Wildfire Relief Aid. As of up until today, so far $353.50 has been raised. Again, the Noising offering will be for that today as well, and this will be the last one. The flowers in the sanctuary this morning are given in memory of Viola Simmons, who was laid to rest here yesterday. Please keep that family in your prayers this week. And it's Reformation Sunday. And funny thing, I'm in demand today. And Ruth is as well. So if church isn't over by 10:05 today, Ruth has to leave. And being it's Reformation Sunday, you know the sermon's going to go on and on and on with Smith here. So, but we might not have time for our last hymn. So I'm going to suggest let's sing our last hymn, Rise, Shine, You People, as the hymn after the sermon instead of the one. And I'll remind you of that again when the sermon's over. But we'll flip that. And then if we do get to the last hymn, well, we'll sing the sermon hymn at that time at the end, whatever. But I am also preaching in Thompson this morning. I got called and asked to do that after I'd already said I would be here today. And I said, well, look, I'm preaching at Salem in Lake Mills, and that's at 9 o'clock, and your worship's at 10:30. That's going to be cutting it pretty close. And they said, we'll wait. So I said, all right, I'll do it then. But so I'm not going to go down for coffee today. As soon as church is over, I'm going to skedaddle and head over to Thompson this morning. Please refer to your bulletin for the other announcements about things happening this week. With that, let's begin with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be God, the one who forms us, Jesus, who bears the cross, the Spirit, who makes our joy complete. Amen. Let us bow before God in humility, confessing our sin. Steadfast and faithful God, you have revealed the ways of justice, yet we fail to follow you. We are overwhelmed by the world's violence and suffering. We are afraid to risk what we have for the sake of others. For the harm we have caused, known and unknown, forgive us. For the unjust demands we place on others and your creation, forgive us. For the ways we turn away from you and our neighbor, forgive us. Lead us back to you and set us on the right path. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Beloved in Christ, God's justice stretches beyond all understanding. God's compassion beyond all compare. In Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are already and always forgiven. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord God, you are the holy lawgiver. You are the salvation of your people. By your Spirit, renew us in your covenant of love and train us to care tenderly for all our neighbors. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. At this time, I ask our children receiving Bibles and their parents and sponsors to please come forward. I'm going to move out so the congregation can see you all. In the sacrament of holy baptism, parents, sponsors, and the whole people of God make sacred promises. And so these promises were made when each of you were tiny babies and were baptized. And I know you can't remember that, but this is what Mom and Dad and everybody else here promised when you were baptized: to live among God's faithful people, to bring our children, you, to the Word of God and to His Holy Supper, to teach them, all of you, the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, to place in your hands the Holy Scriptures, and to nurture and fulfill you in faith and prayer, so that you, our children, may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Parents, sponsors, and all of us gathered here today, do you promise to renew these sacred promises to help our children grow in the Christian faith and life? If so, say, we do. We do. With that, we will hand Bibles to parents and ask you, parents, to place these Bibles in the hands of your children. And again, the idea here is we, the congregation, are part of this, and you as parents are part of this. We're all working together to raise our children in the faith. So we hand a Bible to Cameron Breisitter, Emmy Brackey, Sterling Gonzalez, Charlotte Mosby, Daniel Swanson, Cash Osheim, Emma Gulbvinson, hope I got that right, Avali Wachik, Clayton Helgeson, and third graders, Lily Brackey, Knox Ritter, Cooper Helgeson, Jackson Gilbertson, Gracie Roeder, and David Swanson. Congratulations to all of you. Let's say a prayer before you go back to your seats. Lord God, bless these children. May these Bibles bring them to understand you and your word at a new level. May it help them grow in faith with the work we all do to help them in that as well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yes.
Morning. The first reading today is from Leviticus. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, 'You shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. You shall not render an unjust judgment. You shall not be partial to the poor or defer to the great. With justice you shall judge your neighbor. You shall not go around as a slanderer among your people, and you shall not profit by the blood of your neighbor. I am the Lord. You shall not hate in your heart any one of your kin. You shall reprove your neighbor, or you will incur guilt yourself. You shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. And the psalm is Psalm 1, and we'll start responsibly with the lector. "Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful. Their delight is in the law of the Lord, and they meditate on God's teaching day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper. It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked shall be destroyed." And the second reading is from Thessalonians. "You yourselves know, brothers and sisters, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully mistreated at Philippi, as you know, we had courage in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in spite of great opposition. For our appeal does not spring from deceit or impure motives or trickery. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the message of the gospel, even so we speak, not to please mortals, but to please God who tests our hearts. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with pretext for greed, nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
St. John, the 8th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." They answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying you will be made free?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So, if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed." The Gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, come now and make us free indeed. Amen. Well, you know, I don't know what I was thinking. I looked at the bulletin, but it still didn't dawn on me with the Bibles and stuff today, that was probably going to be in place of the children's sermon, because I kind of had prepared a bit of a children's sermon and even brought my bobblehead Luther with, and now he's here for nothing. So I think he can just maybe shake his head at everything I'm saying while I'm preaching. As you can probably guess, I get excited about preaching on Reformation Sunday. What gets hard is deciding what to preach on each year. I mean, if I just came up here and started talking, we could probably be here for 3 or 4 hours. I promise I won't do that. But the possibilities are endless. Do I preach on one of the appointed scriptures? Do I let that go and preach on something from Luther's life? Do I preach on a theme or some piece from Luther's theology? I was wrestling with some different ideas this week, and I'm sure this is a surprise to you too. Every year at Waldorf, I preach at chapel on the Wednesday of Reformation Week. So yes, I preached at Waldorf on Wednesday this week as well. And I'm usually expected to speak on some Lutheran theme of one sort or another. But this year, on Wednesday in chapel, I never even mentioned Luther. You're as surprised as they were. I simply preached on this gospel from John. And I'm going to do the same this morning. On Wednesday, I talked about the Christ who frees us. Who frees us from even ourselves. Well, a colleague of mine from the English department stopped in my office later in the day on Wednesday to talk about the sermon. And, you know, he got me going on the Reformation, always a mistake. And so we ended up talking for quite a while. But in that conversation, I also got to talking about how not only does Jesus free us from ourselves, but Jesus Christ frees us from religion. He looked very puzzled. So I explained a little more. And he said he had never heard that before. And he said, I think you need to preach on that sometime soon. Well, to me, that's the very heart of the Reformation. And if it was new to him, I got to thinking that maybe this morning I need to go back to the heart of it all. So what I'm going to say this morning might be new to some of you, though I would guess it's probably not. But maybe it's a timely reminder for all of us about what is at the heart of what we're doing here and what it means to be Christian and to live in this faith. In our gospel today, Jesus tells some of the Jews who were following him that the truth will make you free. And he ends that gospel reading this morning saying, the Son of Man will make you free. Did you catch that? There were two. The truth will make you free, and the Son of Man will make you free. But of course, in another part of the Gospel of John, Jesus says, he is the truth, right? I am the way, the truth, and the life. That saying of Jesus is also in the Gospel of John. So when Jesus says, the truth will make you free, it's the same as saying the Son of Man will make you free, because he, the Son of Man, is the truth. So Jesus came to set us free. But the Jewish people in our story this morning asked what they needed to be freed from. They say they've never been slaves. Couldn't we make a similar argument? We are Americans. We live in a nation that gives us maybe more freedoms than any nation in the history of the world has ever given its citizens. We are Americans, and we vehemently protect and cherish our freedoms. From what do we need to be freed? Well, I would argue lots of things. But I want to focus on just one this morning, and it might be a surprising one. Religion. Yes, I would argue Jesus came to save us from religion. And yes, I think we church people, especially we church people, can be enslaved to religion. Jesus came to free us of all things from religion. And I will admit, I still hear people in Lutheran churches often saying things that make me say to myself, don't you get what this is all about? Haven't you grasped the core of it all? But I hear people regularly, even in our Lutheran churches, still caught in the strangling grips of religion. What I mean is that I think religion is often seen as a project we must engage in to win God's favor or to get ourselves to heaven or something like that. To put it more crassly, sometimes I think we view religion as a list of things I need to do to get God off my back. I should know the Ten Commandments and live by them. I should strive to be a good person. I shouldn't lie, curse, drink, gamble, or hang around the wrong people. I should treat people well, go to church on Sunday, do work for the church. I should just be a good person. I should listen to the Jesus who says, love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your mind and all your strength and all your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. If I do all this, God should grant me the gift of heaven. We turn God, and maybe it's appropriate that it was snow outside. Maybe God, well, I know God knew what I wrote for this sermon. Maybe that's what happened here. But maybe we turn God into the Santa Claus from Santa Claus is Coming to Town. You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. And he knows if you've been naughty or nice. Is that what we turn God into? The message there is if you've been naughty and not nice, you're going to be sorry. Religion in that sense is a ladder. If I climb all the rungs of the ladder, I'll get into heaven. That kind of religion is not Christianity. That is not what Jesus was all about. If that is religion, then Jesus climbed down the ladder so that we don't have to climb up. In fact, Jesus climbed down the ladder because we can't and won't climb it. And I would actually argue Jesus destroyed our ladder. There is no ladder to climb. We don't have to make our way to God through some system of religion. We have a God who comes to us. We have a God who was born in a manger to come to us. We have a God who comes here in word, an actual spoken word on the lips of someone to tell us we are forgiven. We have a God who comes to us in water and words. We have a God who comes to us in bread and wine and words. We have a God who comes over and over and over again to tell us he's out to save sinners. People who don't live by his commandments and do what he wants. And that's us. God came in the flesh of Jesus to save us. To save us from having to save ourselves. To save us from a religion we must fulfill to save ourselves. Jesus saves us from religion. So why do we get together here week after week after week? Isn't this religion? Well, I would say no. We're not doing this to get ourselves into heaven. We're doing this to hear the good news that heaven is already ours. But that good news is so good, it's hard to believe. We really can't believe it. We'll slip back into thinking, ooh, is God going to get me for that? So why do we get together here week after week after week after week to hear that good news again and again and again? Because we are hopeless unbelievers. There's something so good about the good news, we just can't believe it. There must be something I have to do to save myself. Don't I have to be a little bit good? Or maybe I have to accept Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. That's the fun stuff that's around in modern Christianity these days. The good news is so good, it's unbelievable. The good news is that Jesus has done it all for you. And in doing so, the Son of Man has freed you from religion. You're now free to quit worrying about yourself and if you've been good enough, or if you've really accepted Jesus, or if you've followed all the commandments. You're freed from all of that. Jesus hung on that cross to take care of you so that you can quit worrying about you. You don't have to worry about being good enough or doing the right thing. And think about this. And to me, this is maybe the most important thing to remember on Reformation Sunday. The problem with that religion that is about climbing our way into heaven is that it makes us even more selfish. If I have to do this and this and this to get into heaven, then I'm doing this and this and this to get into heaven. The good things I'm doing in life aren't for others, they're for me. And religion just becomes one more selfish, self-centered thing in our lives. If you do the right thing just to get yourself in heaven, you aren't doing the right thing anyways. You're just once again being selfish and self-centered. If you feed the poor to get yourself into heaven, you're doing it for all the wrong reasons. But if Jesus already has gotten you into heaven, you don't have to worry about that anymore. Now you can feed the hungry simply because they're hungry. Not looking for any reward or any gift for doing this thing. You just do it because it needs to be done. Now you can feed the hungry without worrying about yourself, but you could maybe feed them out of genuine love and concern for them. That's a good work. When we do something expecting nothing in return, and we don't need anything in return because we already have everything in Christ. When you are freed from religion that makes you focus on you, then you can finally actually be free to serve God's world and give it what it needs. So a reminder this morning, you are free. In Christ you are free, even from religion. Amen.
Rise, shine, you people, Christ the Lord has entered. Our
explanation to the three articles of the creed, and students, I'd ask you to please come up here now. Why don't all three of you come up so you can just lob right in and out. And as they end the explanation of each article, we'll all join in with Luther's words, "This is most certainly true." Start us off.
The first article on creation. I believe that God has created me together with all that exists. God has given me and still preserves my body and soul, eyes, ears, and all limbs and senses, reason, and all mental facilities. In addition, God daily and abundantly provides shoes and clothing, food and drink, house and farm, spouse and children, fields and livestock, and all property. Along with all the necessities and nourishment for this body and life, God protects me against all danger and shields and preserves me from all evil. And all this is done out of pure, fatherly, and divine goodness and mercy, without any merit or worthiness of mine at all. For all this, I owe it to God to thank and praise, serve and obey him. This is most certainly true.
The second article on redemption. I believe that Jesus Christ, true begotten of the Father of eternity, and also a true human being, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, a lost and condemned human being. He has purchased and freed me from all sins, from death and the power of the devil, not with gold and silver, but with holy precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death. He has done all this in order I may belong to him, live under him in his kingdom, and serve him eternal righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. Just as he has risen from the dead and lives in truly eternity.
This is most certainly true.
The third article on being made holy. I believe that my own understanding or strength, I cannot believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord, or come to him. But instead, the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, made me holy, and kept me in the true faith, just as he calls, gathers, enlightens, and makes holy the whole Christian church on earth and keeps it with Jesus Christ in the one common true faith. Daily in this Christian church, the Holy Spirit abundantly forgives all sins, mine and those of all believers. On the last day of the Holy Spirit will raise me and all the dead and will give to me and all believers in Christ eternal life.
This is most certainly true. Thank you, Father. Trusting in the transformative power of God's loving Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need.
Holy God, you give the law that your people live by it and flourish. Write your law on the hearts of all who bear your name, and teach us to love your commandments, that we live as you intend. God of grace, hear our prayer. Holy God, you plant the earth and water it and bring forth a fruitful harvest. Send favorable weather, just wages, and the bounty of your abundance to all who are engaged in the labor of harvest. God of grace, hear our prayer. Holy God, you watch over the ways of the righteous and judge your people with fairness. Guide judges, courts, elected officials, and all those tasked with upholding the law, inspiring them with your wisdom and zeal for justice. God of grace, hear our prayer. Holy God, you hold your people in love and surround them with your mercy. Draw near to all who are in need. Be their rest and comfort. God of grace, hear our prayer. Holy God, you call us to love one another as we love ourselves. Give us the will and patience to love those who are difficult to love. Bless all the ministries of this congregation through which we show love for our neighbors. God of grace, hear our prayer. Holy God, you have broken the chains of death and daily make all things new. We give you thanks for the witness of reformers like Martin Luther and all the saints. We pray that your transformative spirit is at work within us. God of grace, hear our prayer.
And God of all nations, we remember those people in the state of Maine this week whose lives have been torn apart again by endless and senseless violence. We pray that your promise of new life in a world one day where such cruelty, hatred, even illness is a part of our world no more. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
This week, we pray for these Salem members, Randy, Christy, Samuel, and Caitlin Grothy, Dwayne and Judy Goodmanson, Joel and Nancy Gutormson, Carol Hagen, Michael Hagen, God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, into your hands we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your unending love and amazing grace through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. And let us join in the words of our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The God of glory, Jesus Christ, name above all names, and the Spirit who lives in you, bless you now and forever. Amen. And I think we've got time, Ruth. So let's sing the hymn of the day, Love Consecrates the Humblest Act, 360. Peace of the Lord be with you always.